not much of a taskmaster.
Okay. I'm going to talk in the next more or less 40 minutes about applying games in healthcare. Let's see whether this works.
Is it not working? You can probably just use a keypad.
Am I blocking the screen, by the way? Should I go somewhere else? Okay, there's three themes I want to address in this presentation. First of all, I want to give a broad overview of what we think at our research program that games are good at. Second of all, I want to zoom in a little bit on games for rehabilitation, because that is a little bit of a focal point for ourselves as well. I see also there a big poster with rehabilitation games, so I think more people focus on that here. And third, I want to give some practical tips and tricks, lessons learned for applying games in healthcare. First of all, let me check a little bit who's in the audience, because I mainly aimed this presentation at people working in healthcare not having a lot of experience with games. Who of you works in the healthcare organization? That's then not that many. How many of you work in research institutes? That's more. And how many work in game development, in the industry? Okay, so it's quite equally divided. So maybe I'll add some more information also for the other target audience. So to say.
You need to point it directly at the thing. Do you want to switch that?
Oh yeah, I used the wrong button. So a little bit about myself. I always have a very hard time explaining exactly what I do, because it's divided in many little projects. But my employer is the Utrecht School of the Arts. That's the round logo to the left. That's a big art and design school in the Netherlands, in and around Utrecht. And there I teach research skills to first and second year game design students and interaction design students. I was also involved in a big project called GATE. I don't know if any of you have ever heard of that. It's like a huge research project around games and applying games in different contexts that was just recently finished, or it's actually finishing April 1st, and it has been running for 4 years. And a lot of research institutions were involved in that. And at the Utrecht School of the Arts, we made three pilots, of which one was for healthcare, and I will also explain that pilot quite in depth in this presentation. And the logo over there, the egg, that's called, that's an abbreviation for the Expertise Center for Games and Game Design, and that's actually a center that aims to bridge the gap between academia and game design. So we try to make all the knowledge that is being developed in academia, in game studies, about serious games, to make that more available and more accessible for game designers, so that the knowledge can actually accumulate and people can learn from each other also in a practical point of view. And hopefully, in the end, we will develop better and more effective games. So that's, in a nutshell, some of the projects. Well, first of all, when developing games for a certain context, it's always very good to think about what is it that games are good at. When you want to reach a certain goal, it's always good to think about which medium to deploy, of course. And we think that the current popularity of games in society as a whole, I think, is part of a bigger tendency. That is a shift in the way we perceive media. A little bit of theory around that. The old media, so to say, it's television, radio, newspaper. People who are into media studies would know about that. We call them lean-back media. What you basically do, and of course there's the scary image of the couch potato, who only sits on the couch and watches television. Those media don't really require any active input of a user or an audience, other than just watch, read, and listen. Those are the main verbs that you should do when you receive those media. So Basically, I watch, so I experience. It's not to say that the experience cannot be a strong experience. If you really get immersed into a movie, that can be really strong. But the main thing you do is watch, read, and listen. And that is contrary to what we call lean-forward media. And games are a very, well, clear manifestation of that. Those are media that actually require a very active input of the user. And of course, all new digital media do that more or less. But games do that to a very great extent. So it's no longer I watch, so I experience, but I act. You really have to do something. So when you play games, it's really centered about verbs. And those can be any kind of verbs, so not only watch, read, and listen. I don't know if any of you knows this photo series.
Yep.
It's a very, I think it's tens or maybe hundreds of faces of people playing games. And you can really clearly see, what kind of emotions people experience when playing games. Probably they have some kind of, it's called a Firo moment, I don't know if any knows that term. That you have a really big victory somewhere in the end of the game and you really feel like, yes, and now I'm winning. And all the time you spend in it, all the active input you deliver is finally being rewarded. So those are the things you really want to leverage when you apply games anywhere. And you can think of all kinds of different verbs. So no longer those three verbs, watch, read, and listen, but you can think of decide, hit a ball, collaborate, shoot, of course, is a very popular one. Hide, avoid, walk. So when you apply a game in your healthcare context, it's very good to think about what you want to convey with that game in terms of verbs instead of in terms of content or nouns. And what it basically comes down to is that when you design games, you design behavior. You design the way people will act. You can never fully predict it, of course, but it is, you want to at least suggest certain behavior and stimulate that, encourage that. So a little bit of, this is a very simple model we use a lot to also show what games actually are. This is a three-layered model of what a game, it represents a game. Inside of the game there's the rule base, which basically means the mechanics. I think most of the game designers are familiar with that term, but it actually means the inner working of the game. Around that, there is what we call the declarative layer, which explains the mechanics, and it can be any theme. I will explain it with an example later. And around that is the social layer, which means what happens between people. If two people play a game of chess, there will be some rivalry maybe between those people, and those social aspects are all in the social layer. To make that a little bit more clear, so the rule base is really what is inside the game, but you can only perceive the rule base through the declarative layer. And to make it really clear, a very simple example is a game of chess again. You can have a normal theme or you can have a Simpsons theme, but it doesn't really change the game of chess. You still know how to play it. The mechanics stay the same. So you can put basically any declarative layer on a mechanic set, but it won't really change the verbs. The verbs with chess are, for instance, strategize, to think in advance and to think ahead. So that's the declarative layer. And then what happens around the game is the social layer. So it could be just a room where people are playing. Sorry, that was mine. but it's also, for instance, the big communities that often exist around games, especially on the web. Like World of Warcraft has this very big player community who give each other advice. So that's also part of the game, basically. And also when you design a game, you think about how that will work. Of game theory. I want to go into three other things now, focusing on games for rehabilitation. First of all, I will place rehabilitation games in a bigger scope of serious games, what we call applied games. We prefer the term applied because it's less boring, so to say. It's just the same fun games, but you apply them for a different purpose. So I want to place rehabilitation games on a bigger taxonomy and show what I'm going to focus on. And then I'm going to talk about two projects. The first one is a student project called Vogels. It's Dutch for birds, actually. And it was a rehabilitation game for elderly people who suffer from CVA. And next to that, I want to go into Project Dream, which is the gate pilot I talked about earlier. So this is a taxonomy some of you might know. It was made by Ben Sawyer, a very big name in the serious games world. And he kind of shows with this taxonomy, it's not an exhaustive taxonomy. It's also a work in progress, but it's mainly meant to show how huge the field of applied games is. So in how many areas can you actually use those games? And it's not only different sectors like domains, like government, defense, healthcare, education, but also those games can have different goals. I won't go into all those, because then I would be talking for another hour, I think. But just to show you that there is the goal games for health on the column, and there's also the domain healthcare. And in both those rows are already a lot of games. But then Sawyer also made a comparable taxonomy for only health games. So he, again, a lot of rows, like on which level you apply the game. Is it only on a personal level? Is it on professional practice? Or is it for public health, for the whole country, or maybe even the whole world? And also the kind of goals you can have with that. Don't ask me to explain all of those terms, because I don't know what he means by everything. But I just want to show you a few examples before I go into the rehabitainment, as he calls it. But first I want to show a few examples of data collection, patient education, and pain distraction, just that you have a little bit of a sense of the scope. This one is called Folded. Does anybody know it?
Yeah.
This is a game for data collection. It's a crowdsourcing game. Anybody can play it online. And it's meant to, I cannot really explain it in detail because it's quite complicated. It has to do with proteins and protein folding. And apparently a computer is not capable of calculating all the different ways that you can fold proteins. So by having people play this game on the web, you can, you play around with those structures and you can fold it in any direction. They actually gather data when you play that, and that has actually contributed to health science. So don't ask me how precisely, but it has worked, which is, quite cool, I think. So another example is Remission, maybe more well known. It's quite an old game, or old in game terms. It's from, 2005 or something. It's made by Pamela Cato, and she has done a really big research into the effects of this game. It's a game for children with cancer and who take medication for cancer. And you play this avatar who flies around in a human body and has to shoot the cancer cells. And after a really big research with a lot of children playing the game and a lot of children not playing the game, it showed that actually the children that had played the game had a greater self-efficacy, meaning that they were more precise in taking their medicines, and they had more trust in themselves beating the cancer. So also in that area, you can apply games in a successful way. Another thing is maybe a little bit simpler, but also very effective, is just pain distraction. This is a game called Snow World, and it's maybe more a virtual environment. And it is used when people with burn injuries are treated. Those treatments are really, really painful. And they have the patients play the game while they are being treated. And because they're immersed in this really cold world, they don't feel the pain as much. So it's basically just distraction. But if it works, why wouldn't you do it? So those are just a few examples of games in healthcare, and now I want to zoom in more on the rehabilitation games. We had two projects that I think had quite nice results, so I'll just go in depth into those projects. The first one is Vogels. It was made by our own students. And it was a game for elderly people to rehabilitate from a stroke. The client, we always work with external clients at our school to give the students the feeling that they're actually that it actually makes sense what they're designing. The client of this project was a company in the Netherlands, in Tilburg, that makes these kind of devices. And this is a device that supports the arm, so you can put your arm in that for people to rehabilitate, so that compensates the gravity. And you can thereby more easily move your arm and can do your practice more easily. But still, it is of course very boring to do those exercises, because you just go 20 times left to right, 20 times up and down. So the client wanted to make that more exciting. And especially for people who had a stroke, which appear to be people that are mostly older than 75, I think, or 65. Well, that's quite a challenge for third-year students, make a game to entertain elderly people and also to have them rehabilitate. Of course, it was quite far from their normal target audience, so they started doing research into that. The keyword they kept using during the process was immersion. As you also saw with the Snow World example, when you really dive into a virtual environment, it gives you some meaningful context to do things, for instance, exercises, and you can forget about what you're actually doing. It gives you a reason to actually make those movements. So they first of all started doing research into what kind of art, what kind of graphics would address to those people, so that they really feel that this product is made for them. So those people told that they are really, or they had to pick some images from a great number of images, and it appeared that they really liked natural environments. So they tried to make something that would look really natural with natural colors and not cities with a lot of mountains and rivers. And they started working on that. So these are just some sketches that they made. As you can see, they get more detailed every time. And what they also did, they made different iterations. I don't know if that term is familiar to some people. Meaning that they made examples of prototypes all the time, which they tested. I will also go into that later. Which they tested all the time to see whether it works. So they had to come up with some system, firstly, to have the arm movement actually being tracked by the computer. They did that with a webcam in the end, so the image you see at the top right is the view of the webcam above the arm, actually, and the patient. And as you can see, the avatar is just a block now, but it doesn't really matter because it was about the movements and how intuitive the movements would feel. So they tested that a couple of times. And they also went testing a lot with their target audience. Elderly people, but also, as you can see, some younger people with injuries. Just to see whether it actually addressed to them and whether it appealed to them. They also did some research into the sound specifically, also to make it as immersive as possible. They asked them, what kind of sounds would you want? And we had an exchange student for that, and she did a really good job into nailing the requirements that the sound should have at any moment. This is a little movie where you see the game working. The sound is really softly anyway. So first the game calibrates. Is that a word in English?
Yeah.
So that it would be adjusted to the level of the patient. So it asks first the patient to go as far as possible left, right, and up, so it knows when it's actually doing his or her best. Of course, from the research, it became clear that elderly people are not really hardcore gamers, to say the least. So it had to be really easy and really accessible. So it might look like a totally free world, but actually there is a spline implemented, and you can see a bit of the stripes hanging there. It actually follows that automatically. But what you do is steer a little bit to the left or to the right to catch those hovering birds. And whenever you catch one, it's very simple. You see a number up there, and you have another point. It also appeared that the target audience was quite competitive. They, when one had 8 in the playtest, the other one wanted 9, for instance. So that actually worked pretty well. Well, this goes on for a while. In the right top, you see the view of the webcam, which tracks 4 LED lights. And so it can calculate the position of the arm. Of course, he was very happy to play Vogel, so the students were very enthusiastic about that. So this is one example of how you could apply a game in rehabilitation. Another project, and that is the GAPE project, and we've been working on this for, I think, 2 years now. It's called Project Dream, and it has a totally different target audience. That's children with acquired brain injury. The health people probably know what acquired brain injury is. It's actually something you don't have when you are born, but you get it through like a car accident or something similar. And the brains are damaged. And of course, rehabilitation is very, very important for those children to get back into their old lives, if even possible. We were free in this project to set our own target audience. So we did that together with the Rehabilitation Center de Hoogstraat. It's in Utrecht as well. And we talked a lot to them, actually, to ask, okay, what would be a good target audience and what would be their needs? The big pro about this rehabilitation center was that they were already working with games. And that is a really big advantage when you want to speak each other's language, when you want to understand each other, and they're already working with games, so they have some prior knowledge. For instance, they use a lot of Guitar Hero. This is a little girl that, well, she has to learn to stand again. Her leg is injured. And because of the game is so immersive and so engaging, she kind of forgot that she actually stood up while she was playing it, and this helped her a lot. So they already believed in the potential of games. Okay, for this project, I was the design researcher, so to call. So I first did research into the children, the target audience, and their specific wishes and what would appeal to them. So I asked them what they found, what their opinion was about these media utterances. I don't know if you know all of them, probably know a few. There was some nice results. Actually, the most popular, so to say, was the Mario Galaxy one. And well, it might sound as a cliche, but small children really like the saturated colors and the brightness of the colors. But also the humor in the style really appealed to them, like the funny touch of it. So that's those results we gave to the game artists, actually, and they started working with that. Another thing we did during this process was involving a board of experts, not only the people working at the rehabilitation center, but also some people from research centers throughout Holland, and also insurances, to ask them, like, what would be your parameters or requirements if you would want to implement such a game, and what would it gain from? So after all this research, we came up with these targets. First of all, it had to offer asymmetric skills to the patients, because acquired brain injury is a huge target audience. So some children are almost there, and some are only starting. Some can walk, some cannot even stand. So it really had to offer different skills so that you can play different roles and you can still play together, although you don't have the same level. That's why it became a cooperative game in which you have to help each other. You can see that later. And also the physiotherapist told us that rehabilitation is never on one front. It's always on different fronts. And it would be really nice if one game could incorporate all of those. So we had three main domains, which was social, emotional, cognitive, and physical. So physical, obviously, is just having them walk or move their arms. Cognitive is like recognizing patterns. So there's this enemy you have to defeat, and you have to recognize a certain pattern that you can hit him at the right time, because then it will cause the most damage. And social emotional means interaction between the players. So if one player is almost dying and the other one still has a lot of health, he can actually help the other player. But to ask for that and to give that requires some social skills. So those three things we try to incorporate. Another really strict requirement from the therapist was that the level should be adjustable by them. So they should have some other interface where they could, preferably on the fly, change the level of difficulty. And in that way you can have all the players being challenged the whole time and have them in the famous low experience. So this is a picture of three children rehabilitating with the Wii. And what we wanted to do is was actually before, so it's 2.5 years ago I think we started conceptualizing, and it was actually before the Kinect came, so it was actually not possible yet with the Wii to track the actual position in the room. But we did want to do that because we wanted the play to take place between the players and not on the screen over there. So we made, it was a really early sketch we made, like we want to bring the game world to the children and not suck the children into the television, so to say. So this is a picture of a playtest we did. Niels was the main the lead designer on this project, and we playtested as much as possible, which I'll also talk about a little bit later. And here are just some sketches and how they finally worked into more. It's still mock-up, but it's already three-dimensional. We designed four characters. We wanted all the characters to appeal to, they should cover, like, every child could identify with one of them. So we had kind of a really tough boy at the left who would always fight and do a lot of sports. There would be a cute girl. It's maybe a little bit cliche, those things anyway. A more mature girl who would be like the bigger sister and be a little bit also worried about the other ones. And that would be a little cute boy who's maybe only a toddler. And those were also made into the 3D models. And these are a few sketches of the enemy. The room you saw in here, that would be the starting screen. And all the objects to be found in the room would return later on in the dreams of the children. So this object could be found in the room, and later on in the game, that turns out to be this enemy. And you can see the mock-up art and the final art you can see in there, which looks pretty evil if you ask me. So this is just a little video. It's a little bit old because now we have the room with more details and more worked out. We also had a sound designer involved, obviously, and a composer to make the music. I'll just tell a little bit with the footage. So it's a Wii game. I think I forgot to mention it earlier. and this is one of the scenes we worked out in which the children have to defeat the octopus together. And this is some footage of the playtest we did. So four patients collaborate and have to hit the octopus at the right moment. When you approach the television, you can actually hit, but when it attacks you, you have to walk back and you can block its attacks. So you have to time that really well. And in the three circles, you can see the health of the different players. And they can heal each other when they have health left. So that's basically the game. This is just some images of how we made it. Okay, so those were the two projects for rehabilitation. I want to conclude now with just some practical lessons learned. We got that not only from those projects, but also from other student projects we did with clients from healthcare. And the lessons learned are mainly aimed at people who work in healthcare and might want to do something with games. But of course, it's also nice to know if you are a game designer or a researcher. So first of all, if you want to have a game developed in healthcare, take time to choose a developer. I don't really know how many companies there are in Denmark that develop serious games or applied games. But in the Netherlands, there are actually more than you would expect. There's like 70 companies who actually make serious games. And that's quite a lot, but they also all have their own expertise. So some of them might have had clients in healthcare over 10 times. And then they have a big head start compared to the companies who never did something in healthcare, because it is, yeah, you just build up a lot of experience. We already notice it with student projects that you get more and more experience and expertise. So it's good to look at a portfolio of a company and whether they already did something for your target audience or your domain or your specific demands. And it can also avoid a lot of problems later in the project, because maybe the company really wants to make a mobile game because they have made a lot of mobile games before. And then they kind of steer the client into the direction of, yeah, we really should make a mobile game. And then maybe that's not what you want. So choosing the right developer is a key to the success of a game. As I said earlier, and it kind of relates to the first one, is take time to learn each other's language. In the Project Dream with the Rehabilitation Center, I said it was 2 or 2.5 years ago that we started it, but actually it started way earlier, because the head of our department, his wife, works as a physiotherapist at the Rehabilitation Center. So they had been talking during dinner on the kitchen table about games and what they can do, and she had been talking about physiotherapy and he had been talking about games, so they spoke each other's language way before, and they also had the game lab with the Guitar Hero, so that was such a big advantage. So take the time to do that, and also as a game designer, take the time to ask the client, who is often also the content expert, what is your field? What are the core concepts in your field? What do they involve? But also the other way around. What are the core concepts in game design? What is iterative design? What does an artist do? What does a programmer do? What does a designer do? All those things you have to learn from each other. Also, the board of experts we used in the Project Dream really came in handy. We had another pilot for an educational game in which we didn't have such a board of experts, and that really lacked, because you want to look at your product from many different angles, and it's really the case with applied game design. There are so many perspectives on it that you can never all have them in your own head. So invite as many people as possible in the key moments and show them what you have and ask them what would you think of it. Like a healthcare insurance company could come in really handy, because they might even be financing the game in the end. So they have to see the potential also to get them on board, not only to get their advice. So if you work in healthcare, of course, healthcare in itself is very, very big, and you have all those different fields and disciplines. If you want something with games, you are probably the expert, and also take up that role. And I have a little scheme for that. This is something I made to show the typical team composition when you're making an applied game. And as you can see, a lot of people are working as a game developer, typically a game designer, an artist, a project manager, of course a programmer or several programmers, sound designer. But then for an applied game, it's crucial that you also have a content expert or a subject matter expert. And that person almost never works at a game developer's company because, well, at least in the Netherlands, there are usually small companies. They don't have all that expertise inside. So they need you as a client to provide that information. And you should really be part of the team and not say once a month, okay, show me what you got and I'll shoot on it. But really be involved and provide the right information. How much time do I have left?
You've got about, we've started late, so you can have a bit more time.
Okay. because I wanted to give a little example with this takeaway. We had a project, a student project last semester, and it was for an NGO called UPEC, and they are, well, they try to raise awareness on world peace, actually, quite an ambitious aim. And they want to have a game developed that made young professionals aware of all the conflicts that are there in the world, but that you don't see in the news. So, of course, there's a lot of conflicts that are not always shown in the newspapers or at television because you cannot show everything, but that doesn't mean they're not there. So they wanted to make a game about that, but it was quite late in the process that they actually realized that they were the subject matter experts on that subject. So in the beginning, they were only playing the client, so to say. But then we really had to say really explicitly, you are also the expert, so you're part of the team. And then she started sending information every week and also asking the students, how do you want me to deliver the information, which is really important as well. So it really has to be an interplay. So she started sending these Excel sheets with all the different conflicts and the parties that were involved in those conflicts and the different interests those parties had. And in that collaboration, a really nice game was developed, but it really needed this conscious making it explicit that she was actually part of the development team. So another thing, especially for if you work in healthcare and you are the client or you're working on a game development project, is that you are usually the person that has access to the target audience. Like with Vogel's example, they had contacts with all the rehabilitation centers, so they could send the students there to actually test the game. And I also have a little explanation with that. As I told before, the game design process is very iterative. You want to make things and test them the whole time because you want to make sure you're not going on the wrong track. And since game design is behavior design, you can never fully predict what people will do with your product. You have to see whether they will actually respond in the way that you hope they will respond. So iterative design is very important in the whole process. And for iterative design, you need to test, and ideally you test that with the target audience. Of course, inside the developer's company, they will test it themselves, but they are so different from, for instance, the elderly people who had a stroke. So you really want to test with the target audience, and as a client or as somebody working in healthcare, you're probably the one with access to the target audience. And the sixth, that's the last one, pay attention to the big game. I'm not sure anymore who coined these terms, but there's the little game, which is the product itself, the game you can play, But there's also the big game, and that actually corresponds to the social layer I mentioned earlier. So what happens around the game? Do people have the time to play the game? And if so, how much time do they have? So design the embedding of the game in its context as well. Another pilot we did for the Gay Project was a game for mayors. And it was a crisis management game. So mayors had to, well, they don't need to learn how to manage crises, but actually it's more a tool to have them discuss and talk about it, because it's quite a, can be a tricky point, because nobody wants to admit that they think it's quite hard. So one of the stories there is that you, that there is a flood coming to your town, and you have to decide whether you will evacuate people or will you also evacuate all the animals, for instance. So it's quite dilemmas. There's actually no good or wrong. But one of the big issues in the big game there was that mayors are very limited in their time. So you can design a game and build a game maybe with 10 levels, three-dimensional, make it all shiny. But if they only have 10 minutes to play it in their lunch break, they will maybe only get to the first level. So that is part of the big game. If you know in which context the game will be played, you can adjust the game to that. And so they made an 8-minute game. You have to solve a crisis in 8 minutes. And the funny thing is that you can never solve it, because every decision you make will lead up to other issues and other problems. But the strong thing about this game is that mayors started discussing afterwards, also when they were just on another break. So the limited time span really worked out well, and it also worked out because you have the time, the stress of the time running out, which also of course corresponds to we have to make quick decisions when crises are coming up in your town. So the context is also a really important thing to take into account. That was it. I hope it has inspired you a little bit. You can take a look on our website of our research program, agd.hku.nl, and all the projects are a little bit explained there. And you can also send me an email if you want to know more.
You'd be glad to know you've been broadcasting through the entire building, as we're on the same radio length as the entire building. So okay. I think you've had a bigger audience today than you expected. We can have these. Can we have these PowerPoints as well to put up on our site?
I have to look at some of the pictures.
So you'll be able to get some of that. We're going to be setting up a teleconference, but whilst we're doing that, have we got time? You okay there, Morten? Is it working? Have we got somebody on South Korea there yet?
Yes,
he's looking at me right now. Well, if it's all right, we ask a few quick questions, maybe two or three. If anyone's got any specific questions for Lise? Anybody? I'm going to ask the typical... Yes? Go on, yes.
How much time did you spend developing the dream game?
It has this fuzzy front end, as I said, because first of all, there were the kitchen table conversations, and then we started conceptualizing, and it's... Nobody actually worked full-time on it, but the actual development started, 2 years ago, mm-hmm. thinking about doing the research and the sketches and the concept art. Yeah, something like that. And it's finished. Now we have so-called vertical slice, meaning that we made one level entirely, so the art is polished, it has sound, it's all balanced, but it's only two levels. So. Mm-hmm.
It looks brilliant, though.
Yeah.
The activities are similar to the resort game, fighting with swords, where you can either attack or block. And you have these two motions.
And that one is also cooperative?
It's not. No.
Okay,
I just saw that the signals are similar.
Ah.
So it has to do with Nintendo 4D.
Yeah.
Do you have some few comments on the user involvement in your development of games? What are the big issues?
You mean the testing with the target audience?
Yeah.
What the issues are there?
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's sometimes it's it's funny that especially in the healthcare setting that, for instance, the physiotherapist might say that the children with ABI, they cannot have any stimuli. They will be very easily stressed out, and then they get overwhelmed, and then you have the children play themselves, and it seems that they can handle more than their therapists say. We have found a contradiction there a few times. So maybe because the children are just more used at all the different information coming at them the whole day, because they were just born with the media like that, that there's this this contradiction. But that's sometimes you have to watch the actual target audience more carefully. Also listen to their therapist, of course, but also try to keep your mind open to other information.
We can probably take this on to later on. I think there's probably plenty of people to have a chat with you. But thank you again. So round of applause. And